A very good day to you and welcome to the program. It's just wonderful to be on the farm with you. We've got our horses here as well. This is Alaska behind me and Whisper just behind her. These are American quarter horses. They belong to my son. But I want to speak to you about more important things. I want to speak to you about one word, repentance. Repentance. If you look at Matthew chapter 3 verse 8, the Lord Jesus says, therefore, bear fruits worthy of repentance. And if you want the windows of blessing to open in heaven and come down upon you, as I'm talking to you now, the sun has just come out from behind that cloud. It's almost like a sign from God. If you want the blessing of God on your life, you need to be prepared to walk in an attitude and a heart of repentance. You say to me, Angus, what does repentance mean? Repentance means stop living the way you're living and start living for God. Repentance means to say sorry. That's actually what it means. Sorry for what, Angus? Well, maybe the way in which you're treating your family. Maybe the way in which you're treating your boss at work. Maybe the way in which you're treating your children. I don't know. Maybe your attitude towards God. Maybe you're angry with God today. I don't know who you are, sir. I don't know who you are, madam. But I want to read a story for you from the book of Jonah. And I want to show you, there's a man, Jonah, who was a man of God, the Bible says, a righteous man. God told him to go to a city called Nineveh and to tell the people to repent. Otherwise, God was going to destroy that city. My dear friend, that city was so huge that they say it took a man 3 days to walk across the length or the breadth of that city. This was not a village. It was a massive city. And Jonah did not obey God. He tried to run away from God. He was not interested. He did not want to see Nineveh repent. Can you believe that a Christian actually doesn't want some people to be saved, but rather to be punished? That's true. Think about it. But God is such a merciful and loving God. He basically says, whosoever will call upon my name will be saved. And that's found in Romans chapter 10 and verse 13. Now, I don't know who I'm talking to, but I know that I'm talking to some people who feel that you've been disqualified, okay, as being a believer because you've fallen. God says, repent today, stand up, dust yourself off, and move on. God says in Luke chapter 9 and verse 62, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because if you keep looking back, you'll never plow a straight line. I am a sinner saved by grace. So are you, sir. There is not one person who's without sin. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what it says in Romans chapter 3, verse 23. So what do we do, Angus? What we do is we say sorry. We do a 360-degree turn and we go the other way. That's what we do. From what? Well, maybe from abuse. Maybe from alcoholism, drug addiction, pornography, I don't know. Adultery, unfaithfulness, theft, anger, who knows? God says, turn around, repent, and I will heal you. Now the scripture which comes to mind as I'm talking to you now, my dear friend, before we even get to the book of Jonah, is a scripture that is found in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. And many of you know that scripture. If my people who are called by my name, who are those? My people, those are God's people, they are the believers, the followers of Jesus Christ. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves down on your knees, okay, and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then the Lord says, I will hear from heaven, I will forgive all of their sins, and I will heal the land. If you want revival in your country, I don't know where you're watching this program from. You might be in the United States of America. You might be in Australasia. You might be in Europe or Britain. You might be in Africa. God says, if you repent and you pray and you turn from your wicked ways, He will hear from heaven, forgive the sins of the land, and He will heal it. So in actual fact, it's actually very simple. God wants us to follow Him. He wants us to be a holy people. Holiness is the end product of obedience. When we start obeying the word of God, automatically we become holy people. That's how it works. I want to tell you, I come back to this Bible. I love it so much. If we live according to this book, we become a holy people. Because God says in this book, fornicators are not going to heaven. What does that mean? It means if you're sleeping with somebody and you're not married to them, you're not going to heaven. Simple. God says if you're a thief and you're stealing your brother's things, you're not going to heaven. God says if you kill somebody, you're not going to heaven. See? If God says if you're a liar and you tell lies, you're not going to heaven. That's how it works. But if you obey the word of God, then God's going to give you life abundantly. Abundantly. John chapter 10 and verse 10. The thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus says, I came to give you life abundantly. Now, what about you today? Let's go and let's read the book of Jonah chapter 3. Because I feel that I'm speaking to some Jonas. I really mean that. I believe that God wants to give you one more chance. You've been running from God. He says, enough now. No more running. You need to get in to the army of God. You need to realize your calling. Okay? You've slipped up. You've made a mistake. God says, say sorry and move on. Okay? It's as simple as that. Okay? God didn't call good people into the ministry. He called believers into the ministry. There's a big difference. Because there are no good people. It's only by the grace of God that you and I will enter heaven, folks. Only by that. And it's by acknowledging Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. The most famous scripture in this book is John chapter 3 and verse 16. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. There it is. That's the whole Bible in one verse. John chapter 3, verse 16. Let's see what it says in Jonah chapter 3. And I'm going to read it slowly because I really want you to understand this. I believe God is talking to many of our viewers today because he loves you so much. God is saying, I am calling you back, Jonah. Don't run away. Go and warn the people to turn from their wicked ways. Folks, you don't have to be a prophet to see that we are living in the last days. How much more evil must things become before the Lord comes? How many more catastrophes have we got to see before Jesus comes? Tsunamis, earthquakes, disease, pestilence, hunger. How much more before the Lord comes? I'm telling you, Jesus is not coming soon. He's on his way, I tell you. Let's read Jonah chapter 3. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose and he went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, the Bible says, a three-day journey in extent. And Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. And then he cried out and he said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So he's telling the people, repent, because in 40 days' time, the Lord is going to destroy the city. People don't like that, do they? But I want to tell you something. This program that we've got is called Grassroots, because it's getting back to basics. God told us at the beginning, we are not telling you what you want to hear. We are telling you the truth. We are not of those that would tickle your ears to make you feel good, folks. If you really love somebody, you tell them the truth. Because when you tell them the truth will set them free. Verse 5. So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. What does that mean? It means they changed their ways. It means they were sorry for the life that they had been living. Verse 6. Then word came to the king of Nineveh. He was the ruler. You can call him a president. You can call him a prime minister. He was the leader. And he arose from his throne and laid aside his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in the ashes. Verse 7, he humbled himself. Folks, to see a leader sitting on top of an ash heap like Job did, okay, and pouring dust over himself is something to behold, let me tell you. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles. Okay, in other words, he made a public declaration. This was an order from the government. This wasn't, look, if you feel like it, you know, if you love Jesus, no, no. This was an order straight from the government saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock taste anything. Do not let them eat or even drink water. Folks, that's the real deal. Not even eating or drinking water. We're gonna show you, God, how much we are sorry for our waywardness and our sinful life as a nation, as a people. Verse 8. But let every man, beast, be covered with sackcloth and cry out mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil ways, from the violence that is in his hands. Can you imagine what will happen to this country of South Africa? If every man did that, you would have instant revival. Revival means a people saturated with God. Verse 9, who can tell if God will turn and relent? Relent means to change his mind and turn away from his fierce anger so that we may not perish. Verse 10, then God saw their works. You see, God just wants to see your attitude, my friend. That's all he wants. He doesn't want you to try and be like an angel. He knows who you are, but he wants to see an attitude. Start treating your family properly. Start treating your children, your workers properly. And God will see your heart and he will change the situation in your life. Verse 10, then God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God relented from the disaster that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that a beautiful scripture? I read that to my wife the other night before we went to sleep. I said, that describes society today. When God says, if you genuinely repent as a people, from the government right the way down to that old lady, to that little boy, I will change my mind and I will not destroy the place. Folks, we are living in a time which is like no other time since the creation of earth. I really believe that. I don't know why God has chosen you and me to live in these days. These are the most exciting days if you are a child of God, and the most fearful days if you are a backslider. Because God knows your heart. You cannot run away from God. See, if you say, well, I'm going to change my address, I'm going to go overseas, I'm going to go and find a nice, quiet, peaceful country and just go and sit in the hills and be quiet. No, because God's going with you. He lives inside you. He's going with you and he will not let up until you repent. You cannot serve two masters, you see. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 12, verse 30, he who's not for me is against me. He who does not gather with me scatters abroad. You can't live your own private lifestyle behind the door and then tell everybody else that you're a believer, because God knows what's happening. I'm not preaching to you this message because I want some response from you. I'm preaching this message because God's told me to. That's all. You see, I made a pact with the Lord. Sorry, correction. He made a pact with me when I gave my life to Christ. He said, son of man, that's me, I've made you a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore, hear the words at my mouth and give them warning from me. That's you. When I say unto the wicked man that he shall surely perish, and you give him not warning to turn from his wicked ways, that man will die in his sin. But his blood shall I require at your hands. But if you warn the wicked man to turn from his wicked ways, and he heareth not, he will die in his iniquity. But thou, that's me, thy hast redeemed thy soul. I have a responsibility to present the gospel to you. You have a responsibility to accept it or to deny it. That's it. See, if we didn't have that privilege from God, we'd be like these horses in the paddock here. You see, they're lovely animals. I love them. I believe we'll see horses in heaven because Jesus says he's coming back on a white stallion. I believe that. But I want to tell you, they don't have a spirit. They have a mind. Oh yes, I know that. I ride horses. But they don't have a spirit. God has made us, you and me, in His own image. We can make a decision about what's right, and we can make a decision about what's wrong. And we know what's wrong. You say, Angus, how does some poor guy who's up in the Congo or in the Amazon jungle has never ever heard a missionary preach about Jesus? What chance has he got? I want to tell you something now. God, the Bible tells us, has put eternity in the heart of a man when He created us. You can go anywhere in the world. You can go up to the North Pole. You can go into the heart of the Amazon jungle. And you ask those people, is there a God? And they'll say, there is one. They just don't know His name, but there's a God. Who told them that? They know it because it's inside of them. Now that's the same God that's saying to you and me, I've had enough of sin. I've had enough of compromise, especially inside the church. I've had enough of you bending the rules, and now I'm giving you a warning. Bear fruits worthy of repentance. What kind of fruits are those, Angus? Well, there's 9 fruits, isn't there? Love, joy, peace, patience, long-suffering, loving-kindness, gentleness, right? Self-control. Those are the fruits that we need to bear when we're showing God that we are genuinely sorry for our sins. But I want to tell you something now, folks. Apples, you won't find them on an orange tree. And you won't find figs on a thorn tree. Jesus has told us that. He says, you shall know them by their fruit. So I don't care if the man says he's an archbishop, or if he's a cardinal, or whatever he is, a reverend. If he is not preaching this book, don't listen to him. He's an apostate. And he's a heretic. He is not speaking the truth. If God says, I hate murder, I'm talking about abortion, you better believe it. Now you're sitting there, young lady, and you say, but Uncle Angus, I've had an abortion. What do I do now? You say sorry. That's what you do. And you never ever do it again. It's as simple as that. And you move on with your life. And you really mean it. How do I mean it, Uncle Angus? By bearing fruits worthy of repentance. What does that mean? It means you don't ever go there again. That's what it means. I'm speaking to some young men in prison. I want to tell you, young man, you have committed a crime, you have been convicted, and you are now working out your sentence. When you come out of that jail, you are free. In fact, you are more free than most of us who are not in jail. You know why? Because the only difference between you and me is that you have been caught and I haven't. And that ain't no joke. So when you finish, you're free to go. But the Lord says, now I want you to bear fruits worthy of repentance. And that's all there is to it. You say, is it that simple? It's exactly that simple. And there's nobody that doesn't sin. I know. Every day of my life, I repent. And every day of my life, I say, Lord, please give me the grace to move on. And He does. I haven't got it all together. But you know something? I'm on the right road for the first time in my life. Not because of me, but because of Him and what He did for me on the cross of Calvary. Because of His example. And it's written in this book. In 1 John chapter 5 verse 7, there are three who bear witness in heaven. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. That's what the King James Bible says. And the New King James. So this is Jesus Christ in print. So we better believe what He says. He says heaven and earth will pass away, but this book will never pass away. Jesus understands the power of the spoken word so much that when He Himself was tempted in the desert for 40 days and 40 nights, He responded by, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. It is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Folks, if God Himself quote scripture, why shouldn't we? I mean, God is God. He created the devil. The devil's a creation. He could have just told him to push off, but He didn't. He said it is written. I want to say to you, the only way that we will overcome sin in our lives is when we start to appropriate this book in our lives. I have heard terrible, terrible stories that people are even trying to rewrite the Bible to suit their own lifestyle. Folks, I want to cry when I tell you that. You cannot tamper with God's word. The Bible says if you change one dash or one dot in this book, every plague in this book will come upon you. But people don't believe it, and that's why they suffer. You know, people write to me all the time, please pray for me, Angus, please pray for me. I've got this problem, that problem. Hundreds of people. And I love praying for you, and I will continue to pray for you because I love you. But I want to tell you, a lot of the problems, not all of them, a lot of them have been self-inflicted. What does that mean, Angus? It means it's been caused by disobedience. When God has said, do not do that thing, and you have done it, now you have to pay the price. God forgives you, but you have to live with the consequence. Do not be unevenly yoked, for example. Don't marry an unbeliever. Why, Uncle Angus? Because darkness and light have got nothing to do with each other. Oil and water do not mix. So my dear friend, as we conclude, and please, this is not a negative message. This is a positive message. Why? Because God has shown us where we've gone wrong, and He's shown us how to put it right. How do we put it right, Uncle Angus? I tell you how we put it right. We pray, and we repent, and we ask Jesus to forgive us and to give us the strength, Holy Spirit, not to go there again. I know people who have stopped drinking because they've been alcoholics. Don't tempt the devil. Don't go back into the pub and say, I'll show you, I can do this. Stay right away from it. Flee from the devil, the Bible says, okay? Don't even go there. If somebody's got a problem with a sexual problem, don't go near a brothel where there's prostitutes. Go to the other side of the city. Don't be foolish. If you put your fingers in the fire, you're going to get burnt. Let us pray. Father God, we want to thank you for your word. Lord, you've given us an instruction today. You've told us that we need to bear fruits worthy of repentance. Lord, Holy Spirit, we repent of our sin. Maybe you're at home and you're watching right now and you just know there's something in your life. I don't know what it is. You know, and God knows. Just say sorry. I'm going to lead you in this prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, today I repent of my sin. I've realized that I have been fooling myself and you, thinking I was, but I wasn't, because you know everything. Please forgive me. Give me a chance to start again, to be your child. I want to live a life that is full of positiveness, a life that has got a vision, and a life that's got hope. I repent of my sin, and I make a decision to walk your way from today onwards. In Jesus' name I ask this. Amen. Well, there we have it. Okay, now go in peace.